Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Being Better, Stoicism for a World Worth Living In by Kai Whiting and Leonidas Konstantakos. Narrated by Liam Gerrard. Chapter 1. The Promise of the Good Life. Well-being is realised by small steps, but is truly no small thing. Zeno of Citium, as quoted by Diogenes Laertius. Lives of the Eminent Philosophers, Book 7, Chapter 1, Paragraph 26. More than 2,000 years ago, a penniless immigrant, Zeno of Citium, argued that there is only one destination worthy of a lifetime journey. That destination is eudaimonia. For Zeno, eudaimonia represents a destination rather than a journey, because you either reach it or you don't, in the same way either you are in Miami or you're not. If you are near Miami, or almost in Miami, you are still not there. This Greek term refers to a state of being that we tend to translate into English as happiness, flourishing, fulfillment, well-being, or the good life. Zeno believed that the path toward eudaimonia is open to all, and that reaching it is the ultimate purpose and highest aim for humankind, regardless of gender, ethnicity, education level, social status, or general life experience. Our interpretation of the Stoic texts is that the only time this does not apply is when a severe mental disability or cognitive condition, which cannot be rectified with medical treatment or psychological intervention, acts as an insurmountable barrier to someone's ability to enjoy the fullness of the prototypical human experience. He shared his ideas regarding eudaimonia at the Stoa Poikile, the Painted Porch, a colonnade that stood outside the public market in Athens. Although its ruins might not look like much today, Zeno's followers, the Stoics, took the colonnade's name, not Zeno's, to describe their very public approach to philosophy. Then, as now, Stoic ideas didn't take long to spread and take root in people's hearts and minds. In many ways, this book is a contemporary version of Zeno's presence at the Painted Porch. We wrote it for all those who, as they walk through the proverbial public square, believe that they could live the good life and are willing to put in the work to achieve it. Stoicism is a practical philosophy that provides an antidote for troubled times, while it also keeps our ego and excesses in check when things are going well. Stoicism helps us to understand ourselves and other people better and to navigate a path through life's challenges and successes. Zeno and his Stoics understood that the good life is rooted in communal living, which includes partaking in civic duties, building strong local ties, and being open to and appreciative of the universal community that extends across the whole world. Stoicism won't remove all of life's obstacles, but it helps us to think differently about them. It won't provide us with all the answers, but it gives us the ability to form the questions that ultimately lead to the solutions. Stoicism may be more than 2,000 years old, but Zeno's wisdom is as powerful as ever. In the ancient world, Stoicism was practiced by a wide variety of people, some of whom you will meet in the coming chapters, as we consider how Stoicism can improve our lives today. These include Zeno himself, who was a merchant, his student, Cleanthes, who was an ex-boxer and labourer by night, and another two students, Chrysippus, who was a former long-distance runner, and Spherus, an educator. Spherus took Stoicism to Sparta and worked alongside a Spartan king and queen to reform the city's laws and warrior schools, agoge. A century later, Panaetius, a member of a prestigious and celebrated family, re-envisioned Stoic ideas and used his political and social capital to promote Stoic learning among the Roman elite, which led to Stoicism becoming the philosophy of choice for statesmen of the Senate. These included Cato the Younger, who, in line with Stoic principles, took a stand against the tyranny of Julius Caesar. Stoicism also inspired the first century philosopher-teacher Musonius Rufus, who withstood exile twice and once stood in the way of an imminent battle in an attempt to prevent it. Emperor Marcus Aurelius leaned on Stoic philosophy during his many war campaigns against the Germanic tribes. Stoicism drove scientific inquiry and encouraged the polymath Posidonius to travel far and wide in his quest for knowledge. Stoicism also gave hope to those situated on the lowest rungs of the social ladder, none more famously than the disabled slave Epictetus, whose lectures, written in the common vernacular, would thousands of years later be appreciated by all those looking for the promise of the good life. Why has Stoicism endured, and why is it useful for us today? Because, in short, it provides us with useful tools and methods for reflecting upon and reframing our thoughts so that they serve rather than impede us, so that they build rather than destroy our communities, however difficult a challenge we face. In the modern world, Stoicism is known to have helped prisoners of war, including Vice Admiral James Stockdale, and those sent to concentration camps, such as Dr. Viktor Frankl, to find meaning and persevere in the face of torture. It has inspired those of high political office, including Theodore Roosevelt, to carefully consider and deliver on their decisions. More recently, Stoicism was used by the software engineer and American writer Susan Fowler to survive and then blow the whistle on her tech employer's highly toxic work culture. In fact, Fowler's Stoic influence sense of courage and justice led her to write the 2017 blog piece that kickstarted Silicon Valley's own #MeToo moment. Stoicism is equally valuable for those facing long-term unemployment or those unfortunate enough to contract an incurable disease. The late modern Stoic philosopher Lawrence Becker contracted polio as a small child, a disease that left him with upper body paralysis. Stoicism informed his professional and personal life so much that he went on to play a key role in disseminating Stoic ideas to new audiences. It can help parents who are looking for advice on child raising, or those who have just lost their parents and are tasked with clearing out their belongings. It can help you decide how to best spend and save your money, whether you have a little or a lot. It can assist you in selecting a career or retirement plan. Both Leo and I, this book's authors, have discovered the healing, practical benefits of Stoic philosophy in our own lives. While this book is co-written, and each author is an equal contributor, we decided that Kai would speak in the first person and Leo would not. This is to enhance readability. Thus, we use Leo and I when we want to refer to or distinguish ourselves as individuals. For me personally, no moment has been more profound than the afternoon in January 2016 when my grandmother, Sheila, died. A week previously, she had been taken ill with a heart condition, surprising everyone given her active lifestyle. As Sheila was the rock upon which my family was built, I was convinced she would pull through. It wasn't that I had never considered the possibility of her death, rather that such an abstract thought had always slipped away before I could dwell on it. Therefore, it wasn't until her passing was announced in the hospital waiting room that I realised the gravity of the situation. Memories of her would remain, but no new ones could be created. In that moment, it dawned on me that I would go on to do and say many things, but Sheila would no longer see or hear them. For the first time, I understood the finality of death. The immediate feelings were pain and sadness, but it was the inability to change things, the impossibility of sharing new life milestones and successes with her, that cut the deepest and lingers on. Sheila's death triggered an urgent need for me to reprioritize my life purpose, which, up until that point, had been focused on becoming a prestigious university professor rather than a better person. While there is nothing wrong with wanting to succeed professionally in life, it is not more important than developing a good relationship with oneself and others. I didn't feel regret, for such an emotion felt pointless, especially as I couldn't turn back the clock or bring back the dead. However, I wanted to construct a future where I would have the presence of mind to pay more attention to the things and people I cared about. I didn't want to lose someone else before I adjusted my values. I decided to make this change the moment I left the hospital, and every day after that. The next question I faced was how to become better. Call it luck, fate, or destiny, I didn't have to look far for answers. They were already in my hands, contained in a book that I had brought along to make the anxious hospital visits a little more bearable. The book focused on the wisdom of the Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius, the most famous Stoic philosopher. The more I read, the more I became convinced that the path to being a better person started and ended with Stoicism.
The power of Stoicism lies in its unique view on what it means to be happy, that is, to achieve eudaimonia.
This state does not depend on eliminating life's perils and potholes. Stoicism works because it is designed to help us find meaning and take positive action regardless of our circumstances and how we feel about them. It asks us to commit to seeking and progressing in virtue rather than mere pleasure, to value long-term character building over short-term gains, and to hold ourselves accountable to our own moral code rather than adhering to arbitrary rules or following practices promoted by the latest celebrity or guru. Stoicism isn't focused on esoteric or abstract matters. It is not about specific practices or philosophical life hacks or strategies for getting ahead. Nor does it offer up tips or tricks for shaping our abs, gaining likes on social media, doubling our salary overnight, or tidying up our living space. Instead, it makes it very clear that becoming the best version of ourselves involves striving for an excellent character, one that can effectively help us create a world worth living in, both for ourselves and for others. Stoic philosophy has its origins in what most would consider a catastrophic business failure. Zeno, then a merchant aged 30, was on his way to Athens aboard a ship carrying his precious cargo of a purple dye called royal purple.
There is very little surviving evidence of Zeno's life. With the little we have, Leo and I have tried to piece together his life's flow, and with some evidence-based speculation on our part, we present in this book an insider's view on Zeno's journey into Stoicism.
This dye was so expensive that only the elite could afford to wear clothes of that colour, and thus its sale was going to make Zeno a rich man.
Extracted from the blood of the rare Murex sea snail, this dye was, interestingly enough, the one that the Stoic emperor Marcus Aurelius mentions when he reminds himself in Meditations that even the royal colour of purple is, in the end, only the blood of dead shellfish. Royal purple thus connects the first and last of the famous ancient Stoics.
However, as fortune would have it, the ship went down in a storm, and just like that, Zeno's business prospects drained into the sea. Zeno survived, but as he sat soaked on the shore at Athens, his gratefulness over being alive soon warped into nervousness. With nothing to sell, Zeno was no longer a merchant, as much as a destitute immigrant far away from his home in Cyprus. Just a few hours ago, he had been picturing an altogether different kind of life. Dreams now dashed like the wrecked hull he could see bobbing up and down on the waves. How would he ever rebuild his business? How would he repay his suppliers' loans? What did fate have in store for him? Ultimately, what did all this mean? Sitting alone, Zeno could not answer these difficult questions, so he set off on a 200-mile round trip to seek guidance from the Oracle of Delphi, the priestess of the Greek god Apollo, who was respected and revered all over Greece for her divinations. Even kings would travel for days to seek her counsel, and while today it might seem ridiculous to heed the utterings of a young woman in a trance-like state, a trip to Delphi was taken very seriously indeed. Every meeting was an involved process that had more in common with South American ayahuasca rituals than, say, visiting a clairvoyant. The oracle required visitors to prepare in both body and mind, and as with ayahuasca ceremonies, those seeking answers at the temple at Delphi had to adhere to strict rules in order to approach the ritual with reverence, respect, and sincerity. You couldn't just rock up to the oracle, hand over some coins, and demand that she saw you. Nobody could sit in the oracle's presence until they had properly considered the dangers of misinterpreting her advice, and also understood and pledged to abide by the three maxims of self-discovery: know yourself, nothing to excess, and surety brings ruin. Wisdom seekers were told to listen carefully to what she said in relation to their strengths, weaknesses, personal quirks, and the specific roles they played in the wider world, as, say, a daughter, mother,
Spartan queen. Zeno kept all this in mind as he told the oracle the story of his shipwreck, and she advised him to take on the pallor of the dead. On his return journey home, Zeno weighed her cryptic words carefully, because it was imperative that he interpret them well. What could they possibly mean? As Zeno approached Athens' city gate, it occurred to him that, above all, he must commit to pursuing the ancient wisdom that had been passed down by venerated and now long-dead philosophers. He promised himself that he would re-examine the kinds of philosophical texts his own father had read to him while still a boy. In particular, he was determined to get hold of the ones that spoke about the good life, that is to say, a life worth living, not just one that is, or will ever be, easy, comfortable, or pleasant. In line with the oracle's prophecy, at the precise moment when Zeno was reading about Socrates, who Greek philosophers considered the wisest man to have ever lived, another well-known philosopher, Crates of Thebes, happened to stroll by. The two struck up a conversation. Crates agreed to mentor Zeno, and so began Zeno's journey toward eudaimonia. In time, Zeno would declare that the good life is open to all who actively search for it, because, he argued, while wealth is typically preferred to poverty, and full health typically preferred to illness, neither is essential to happiness. For evidence, he pointed to all the people who were both wealthy and healthy and yet still lived a life of misery. The universality of flourishing, based on the belief that eudaimonia is available to all, was not a position everyone agreed with. The Athenian elite, including Aristotle and his followers, believed that the good life could only be attained by those who had certain qualifications: the right education, male gender, good looks, and Athenian citizenship. For Zeno, they couldn't have been more wrong. In order to reach all those in Athens who were interested in pursuing the good life, Zeno took up a position on the Painted Porch, which was the entryway into the city's central market, the most important shopping mall of its day. Why did he choose this particular location? For one thing, it was the perfect place to master the art of dialogue and negotiation, because it was frequented by just about everyone, Athenians and immigrants, slaves and slaveholders, the wealthiest members of society, and the poorest living in the streets. For another, the porch's design allowed Zeno to engage with those who might otherwise have walked by. On hearing his message, many in the crowd understood that their lives and their hometowns could become so much more as long as they set their sights on eudaimonia rather than mere existence. Zeno's particularly austere and disciplined approach to Stoicism was not to claim bragging rights or to refocus his business priorities after his dye had been washed into the sea. The Greek comedian Philemon could not help but highlight Zeno's uncanny ability to teach hunger and yet still get lots of pupils. In fact, he often remarked that he had made a prosperous voyage only after his cargo had sunk, precisely because his commercial ruin made him care more deeply about the things that mattered. Not wealth or status, but the development of an excellent character and a cosmopolitan spirit, values exemplified by a commitment to making the world a better place for yourself and others. Zeno's good character eventually earned him widespread fame and respect. Before long, he had won the Athenians over to Stoicism. Of course, had he been only self-serving, virtue-signalling, or playing poverty from the comfort of a huge estate, the Athenians would not have cared who he was or what he said. But care they did, and in sufficient numbers to give him the keys to the city and offer him Athenian citizenship, an honour that he politely refused. Posthumously, a statue was erected of him in recognition of the positive impact he had made on the world through the establishment and leadership of the Stoa, Stoicism's philosophical school, and the path he had cleared for others to venture down. This path isn't easy to follow. This is because Zeno made it clear that a person's ability to progress toward the good life rests on the enactment of principles and not simply on blindly following rules. A principle is a proposition or value that guides our thoughts, actions, and judgment. It is the essence of our moral operating system, and, not unlike a compass, it directs our steps. Given that the signposts on the Stoic path are principles rather than rules and regulations, we must think for ourselves every step of the way. No quote on a fridge or scribble in a journal will change that fact. Nothing provides insight if we don't take the time to check our bearings and ready ourselves for the twists and turns that lie ahead. The need to distinguish between rules and principles is something that Epictetus, an ancient Roman Stoic philosopher, warned us about 350 years after Zeno's death. If you're writing to a friend, grammar will tell you what letters you ought to choose, but as to whether or not you ought to write to your friend, grammar won't tell you that. In effect, what Epictetus is saying is that no one can tell you how to live your life because you must reason for yourself and live accordingly. You must take Stoic principles and make them work for you. You must choose which rules or practices can be accepted and integrated or rejected and dismissed. Sooner or later, you must also decide if you stand for something or if you are just standing around, letting others speak up, waiting for them to make the difference in the world. Your world. Zeno held that excellent character must be the guiding light for our interactions with other people and the world around us, exemplified by our adherence and enactment of the four Stoic virtues of courage, justice, self-control, and wisdom. For instance, if you decide to change your diet to avoid coffee and become a vegetarian, perhaps to be healthier and save money, remember that this also affords you with a wonderful opportunity to express all the Stoic virtues, not just self-control. Making wiser choices about what to eat could include learning about commercial food production and fair trade and changing where you shop and who you buy food from. As you save money and consider the Stoic virtue of justice, you might spend some of the savings on just causes by supporting local or grassroots initiatives. You could invest money in a small startup that aims to bring local produce to people's doors or join neighbours who are developing a communal garden. Such actions are in line with the ancient Stoic practice of bringing people into our inner circle or under our wing. They also help us better understand what needs to be done and what lies within our power to make the world a nicer place. Self-restraint, merely for the sake of it, does not support the common good and thus falls way short of the Stoic ideal. In fact, the ancient Greeks in general weren't shy about calling out those people who failed to support the common good because they spent too much time on themselves or their business affairs. They certainly didn't regard them as geniuses, nor did they wish to emulate them. In fact, they referred to them as idiotes, quite literally, idiots. This is why Zeno and his students, particularly Spherus, whom we will get to know in Chapter 7, admired Spartan discipline. Spartan warriors were praised if they continued to fight after having lost a helmet, as it offered them only personal protection, but they were admonished if they discarded their shield, since this endangered their fellow soldiers, whose survival depended on tight, interlocking shield formations. This nuanced understanding of the Spartan code of conduct is a far cry from the egotistical and macho Sparta of pop culture, or indeed from the type of Stoic philosophy that gets promoted by experts on social media, life-hacking blogs, and in mainstream newspapers. While not all bad, many articles that promote Stoicism today are written by people who mistake business acumen for virtue. Stoicism is a big tent that caters to all walks of life, but people who are only interested in themselves and refuse to engage in anything that might perturb their peace are not pursuing Stoicism. They are pursuing Epicureanism. The Greek philosophical school of Epicureanism developed out of a garden owned by Epicurus. He held that the goal of human life was happiness, and that it was achieved by the absence of physical pain and mental disturbance. Various ancient Stoics wrote at length about why they disagreed with him. Stoicism has always been a self-help philosophy with a twist, precisely because it helps us to develop the critical thinking skills and moral accountability that stop us from mistaking feeling better with being better. As Zeno taught, being better means that we are more intentional in our progress toward living virtuously. Stoicism isn't only about contemplating and working toward our own sense of happiness. How could it be? Zeno describes the road to eudaimonia as one paved with conscious and consistent acts of thinking and acting wisely, bravely, justly, and temperately. Nothing in Stoicism is merely done for our own sake. In fact, a Stoic would go as far as to say that if our thoughts, actions, and attitude do not benefit the whole, world, country, community, family, and so on, then we are very much mistaken in thinking that they will benefit us. For Leo and me, the impact of Stoicism on our daily lives is perhaps most noticeable in our attitudes and actions concerning the ethics of our consumer choices. Our academic research and our desire to live a Stoic lifestyle, not just talk or write about it, have led us to think deeply about the interconnection of all things, especially when it comes to how our actions can cause others to pollute the air, soil, and water on our behalf. Also, as both of us want to be good people, by which we mean not cruel or carelessly contributing to cruelty, we are becoming increasingly careful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.